You're listening to the SWN podcast.
And this is SWN.
Welcome to SWN.
Skull! Skull! Skull!
This is SWN.
And this is the Scottish Wrestling Network.
Where Scottish wrestling lives, I guess. Is that a tagline? I guess. I don't know.
Hello and welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy, and I am joined by another returning guest to the show as we're on the road to episode 300 of the SWN podcast. How we got here, I don't know, but we needed to get past episode 134 initially, which is when last time my guest was on for a full episode. He was on another time, which we'll speak about in a little bit, which was a bit of a chaos in general. Joining me is the most handsome man on the planet. I said last time in my last intro that I was the second most handsome man on the podcast. I think that's still the case. Joining me at this time is SBX. Welcome back.
Thanks for having me back.
I'm so glad to have you back. I think when I was going back through season one, season two guests, you were pretty much high on the list of people I wanted to get back on, because when I started doing this podcast, I knew very little. I still don't know a lot, but I knew very little about podcasting, and going back through those episodes going, oh, I could have done more, could have done better, I could have got more. I've lost words already. We're not even 5 minutes
more
in.
Content, more content. But I mean, like, this is the reason why we're here, episode two of SBX, or two and a half, if you call it that. And yeah, just obviously since we last spoke, a lot has changed as well. So yeah, I think it's a good time to have me back in SWN.
Absolutely. Because I mean, last time it was March 22 is when the episode went out, and everything was still kind of fresh. It was not even 6 months back after lockdowns. And I think going back through those first few episodes, especially one with yourself as well, it felt like we didn't know what was happening. It was kind of tense. We didn't know what the landscape of wrestling was going to be. Mm-hmm. We were just kind of muddling through it and hoping for the best and trying to maybe find some positivity out of it, which at the time was a bit difficult, if I remember rightly. But now it's 2 years later, 2.5 years later, hopefully we've found some positivity out of it as well. But we'll kind of tackle that as we go through it. So last time we spoke, I had my notes in front of me and they've suddenly disappeared. You were just due to go over to Ireland, or just about, I think.
Quite possibly. So that was right before, funnily enough, I faced LJ Cleary. So that was the last time that we spoke. It was right to go over to the OTT training camp, and then was successful in the training camp, and then ended up being selected to be part of the show and go one-on-one against the MVP of Irish Wrestling, LJ Cleary. And funnily enough, next Friday from now, when this comes out, all said and done. But yeah, I go one-on-one once again for the second time ever against LJ Cleary. And obviously he's just came back from his trip at NOAH as well, internationally travelled, got to wrestle some of the best on the planet. This weekend from his recording, he goes one-on-one with Nick Nemeth as well, formerly known as Dolph Ziggler, which is a massive influence on my wrestling career as well. So really excited to see what LJ Cleary can bring to the table for his title match for CPW as well. So yeah, that was way back March 22.
So is this kind of like a bookend moment for you, that you're going in? That was November 22. I've got noted here now. I've got my notes now. So that was November 22 that you faced LJ Cleary, and then yeah, like I said, you're about to face him this coming weekend. Are you going to treat that as like a bookend moment of how far you've come in that time, or you just take it as
certainly. I think like both LJ and I have grown a lot as performers. Like LJ and I have known each other for years, and to be honest, it's a shame that this is only going to be the second time that he and I have faced one another in the ring as well. But yeah, looking forward to test myself and seeing how far I've grown since we've face each other, and really, once again, what he brings to the table in his miles travelled as well. Not to say that we were like fresh-faced wrestlers back in 2022, but this time there's more in the line as well. And even since then, I think him and I have both exponentially grown as performers, and right now, like, I would argue that I'm on the run of my career, just in terms of match quality. Like, you speak to anyone who's leaving a CPW show over the past few months and they say matching in a SBX, undoubtedly. So, yeah, really looking forward to next week and seeing what LJ Cleary can do.
I mean, certainly looking through like your match tally since our last chat, and not only putting on the best matches of the night, and you're saying people are leaving shows saying that, the fact that you've been quite the belt collector as well, picking up title accolades during that time. I mean, this is, again, just before, I think we recorded, and then you did the match at CPW where you won the UCW, that brawl, tag team titles with Levi. I think that was the initial Handsome Man's Club.
Actually the second iteration of the Handsome Man's Club. The initial iteration of the Handsome Man's Club was with C.S. Rose.
Of course, yes.
That name back in the day, and I've still got the original memorabilia of that particular stint of the Handsome Man's Club in the house where we're recording today. And then, as I said, the second iteration was with Levi. And not mentioned there, I looked Cairo as well. That was iteration two. I said we picked up the titles in 2022 as well. So that was my first foray into championship gold.
And it's on CPW, of course. CPW have seemed to have got this huge working relationship with quite a lot of companies like Upbrawl and OTT as well. And it gives you a chance. So we're going to mention a lot of things about your CPW title run at the moment, but it gives you a chance to get new fresh-faced opponents and different opponents that you're not going to get anywhere else in Scotland. Is that something that CPW, that you pride yourself being in CPW, that you can get these opportunities against talent from all over Europe? Because we've had French athletes as well over, and French, all that. Is that something you enjoy?
Americans over as well. No doubt in the future we will have Spanish and Portuguese as well. We have made relations across the sea to do talent exchanges and likes as well. We've had the trendiest school in the whole of Brit Rest. I don't like the term Brit Rest, but British Wrestling, Pursuit Pro Wrestling. They've came to the school as well. So CPW, absolutely the number one promotion in Scotland, without a doubt. Like, there's no one that can come close to it in terms of the roster and in terms of the variety that we bring to shows. And like, we give people real value for money as well. There's always such a great atmosphere. I mean, you've been to the shows yourself as well. And you got to experience that atmosphere, and you got to experience a wee bit more as well. But CPW, absolute number one for in terms of the talent they bring in, the challenges that they bring me as CPW champion, and just the offering that we can give the CPW fans as well, absolute number one.
So that was the second version of the Handsome Man Club. We would have no doubt spoke about CS Rose as the first version in our previous episode, so people can go and check that out. I mean, the Handsome Man's Club seems to always kind of be in your vicinity, of course, being the most handsome wrestler, most handsome man being your moniker. So are you always kind of on the lookout? I mean, you've got your Handsome Man's Club now, which we'll get to the formation of that, but has this always been lingering since CS Rose, and then when Levi, that kind of didn't continue? Has it always just been a thing?
Levi and Luke Cairo just didn't quite pan out at all. They weren't performing to the standards that the Handsome Man's Club demands of them, essentially. And their last match as the Handsome Man's Club within CPW was against The Par, I believe, who are obviously PWR Pros Tag Team Champions, I believe. as well, but this is like earlier in their careers where they're still quite green, not having the accolades of the tag team championships, and yet Levi and Luke still lost the match to these newbies sort of thing. So after that, it was just done, finished with it. If you can't perform to the level that I expect as a Handsome Man's Club, then you're out, and that was that. So from then on, it was a bit of a one-man gang, quite exclusive as well. But like you're right in terms of, like, it takes a village to raise someone, you know? And with that, did have my lookout. So I myself, really, I can put this like run of my life and this kind of, I don't know. I don't really know quite how to describe it as well, but I felt like ever since I've joined Joe Hendry's School of Wrestling, I felt a lot more confident in myself as a wrestler, as a performer, as like an overall package as well. And the great thing about Joe Hendry's School of Wrestling is that there's people that I may have not seen before as well, and because it's got the name Joe Hendry, it's got people coming from all over Scotland just to train as well. And that's where I've seen Ronan King and Judas Gray and Asho Vega in there.
The Joe Hendry School seems, you're right, it's, I think it's, from what everything I've learned about the school anyway, the Joe Hendry School now, the Disco Academy, is the amount of people that Joe brings in, because Joe Hendry is a very busy man nowadays. You know, he's just appeared at NXT Great American Bash against Joe Coffey, which, as a Scottish wrestling fan, is mind blowing to think about. Yeah. These guys had battles in Discovery, and now they're doing it in NXT. But the fact that he's busy doing that, but is still able to bring in the likes of your Lost Boy Aspen, your Emerson Jane, your Ian Skinner, he's able to bring in, Dave Conrad as well. He's able to bring in people that have a little bit of information about some things, but everyone collectively has a corner of some sort of thing, a skill covered as well. And is that something you found at the school, that maybe you go in with someone, they don't have what you need, but they have like a little bit of information that you can take, and someone else got a bit of information you can take, and that's collective.
I think it is. I think you do need to learn from many different styles as well, as you said. Like, so if you're talking Dave Conrad, obviously he's like wrestling sort of thing in terms of your traditional Greco-Roman wrestling as well. Then you speak to Emerson Jane, who's once again world traveled as well, puts herself in the ring against some of the best, like males and females, within the UK and abroad as well, and is quite versed in different styles herself. Same with Lost Boy Aspen, quite into, even though he never does it, is a kind of traditional British style of wrestling as well. So yeah, you're right, it's good to take little tidbits of knowledge from like here, there and everywhere sort of thing, and apply it. And that's why the Disco School is doing so well, and it's great just in terms of, obviously some of the coaches there as well are pushing their trainees to get out with Scotland and go elsewhere and give them these opportunities, because like iron sharpens iron, you know, you're only going to get better by putting yourself in the ring against some of the best as well. And even if you don't come up with the win, then still, you know, you just take it as a learning experience, you walk away from it and you ask yourself, what could I have done better as well? And from that you can all get better and better and go from strength to strength as well. And that's one of the key pillars of the Handsome Man's Club as well. Even if you don't walk away with the win, then dust yourself off, take the L, take the knowledge from it, and then move on and make yourself better.
At least look good doing it. If you lose, so we'll get back off the Handsome Man's Club, because again, that's a big part of your current run of your life in Community Pro. But still in Community Pro a little bit, is you won your first singles title there, which was the Scottish Interpromotional Championship, which it was brief. The raid was brief, but it still counts. It's still on our history books. It's still on the title history of the site under Pro 2. So winning a singles title, even though it didn't last long, because Saqib Ali took his rematch clause to heart and straight away.
Yeah, but personally,
in that 3 minutes, how did it feel to finally be able to hold a singles title in wrestling?
Yeah, like great. It was just one of those things that was for me, honestly, quite a long time coming as well. Like, and you've been kind of in terms of the work that I've been putting in for the past few years, absolutely deserving of a title. And yeah, it just wasn't Saqib's Ali match for him, but I couldn't exactly say it's not Saqib's night because he did win the belt straight back off me after a few moments. But yeah, that night was my night, I guess, and just in terms of the match. And yeah, just that elation. And it's just, I think that's the thing about community pro wrestling as well. Like, that's, they're the company that put me in that position as well to have a title match, which is absolutely great as well. And then, as I've said before, it's just kind of went from strength to strength in that regard as well. But yeah, pure elation when I won that for the 3 minutes.
I mean, speaking of being put in positions at CPW, one match that popped up when I was scrolling through, I thought I need to write that down to talk about it. A blindfold match with Darrow.
Yes, we're coming.
Blindfold matches are an art within themselves. But yeah, I don't understand how, like, I mean, there's the mechanics of it, and if you want to strip it back, it could spoil a blindfold match and all that kind of stuff. But there's still the fact that you've got, regardless of the thickness of the material, you've still got a mask over your face, and there's still going to be limited visibility, no visibility.
Yeah, exactly. And you can't exactly train for a blindfold match, can you?
That's what I was going to ask. Yeah, how do you kind of prepare yourself for that kind of match?
You don't. Like, I think I was in a fortunate position in the fact that I have been wrestling and been training for a number of years now as well, and it's pure instinct that you go off of as well. I mean, so it was, the blindfold match was myself against Darrow, who himself is a champion within CPW right now as well. And yeah, Darrow, great work ethic, I believe, even though he's the ugliest sin, which is a real shame. Got put in a blindfold match with him. And yeah, I don't even know, I can't remember why we got put in the blindfold match, if there was an issue that he had with me or I had with him at the time, just because obviously a number of years ago now as well. But yeah, you're right. You can't train for it. It's pure instinct you need to go for. You need to, like, try and block every punch. Obviously, every goal in every match, that a goal of mine is to protect the face, because this is the real moneymaker as well. Mm-hmm. Like, cool, you get paid to win matches and you get paid to wrestle on the likes as well, but like, this is the real moneymaker. This is the thing that, like, sells the t-shirts. This is the thing that sells the photos, like, sells all the merch that you can as well. That's the real moneymaker. And like, people won't come up to me if I've got a shiner, if I've got a missing tooth. So yeah, that was real scary, not knowing what's getting thrown at you as well. And even when we fell outside the ring as well, and then now you need to make it back into the ring as well, and you don't know where you're going.
And it's the CPW crowd, which are terrifying, to be honest. Yeah. They're not forgiving for anything or anyone.
Yeah.
And even like, it was fair for club and Glovin, you had that match, which, you know, probably it would be a benefit not seeing the crowd, because, you know, but it doesn't matter whether it was there or up in Pierhead. When I got to see you, I think that was the first time I got to see wrestle live as well, mm-hmm. was Pierhead in that four way, which was your first opportunity that I've got recorded anyway at the CPW Heavyweight Championship. It was a four way. It was yourself. It was Thatcher Wright, Mayhem Brooks, and
Darrow.
It was Darrow again. So
yeah, Darrow again. That's
it. So, which I said in my review at the time, and I said it before, but somehow Ravy Davies is able to take the Govan crowd and then just transport it wherever he goes. So he even took it to Peterhead, and that was a wild night. The match itself, that was your first opportunity, and you came like within a ball hair away from becoming CPW Heavyweight Champion in Peterhead. Yep. This wasn't the first time you wrestled there. You wrestled Xander earlier in the year at the same mm-hmm. venue. But before we talk about the title match itself and everything that, that we had there, wrestling at a football ground, is that kind of a little bit of bucket list stuff for you? Is that something that, that like intrigues you to be able to do that?
Absolutely. Like, just the fact that you can say you've wrestled in a football stadium, it's just absolutely surreal. Really cool. And yeah, just obviously, like, you know yourself, within these matches as well, they do tend to spill outside a wee bit as well. So there was actual fights within the stadium itself as well, not even in the function seat, but like brawled right out onto the pitch, onto the chairs, just absolute carnage as well. So I'm thankful that Peterhead Football Club had his back for a second and even a third show up north. But yeah, just absolutely mental. And yeah, that's not going to be the only time that wrestle on a football ground as well.
Of course, we've got Hamilton, yes. Academical.
Yes, Hamilton. I'm an academical about 10 days from now as well. And that brings us back to the Handsome Man's Club, I guess, as well, versus the Govan team. And that we are creating Hornswoggle as well. So yeah, getting to wrestle within Hammond Academical Football Ground, which is close to home for me as well, because a lot of my life outside wrestling was spent in Hamilton at university as well. So it's cool coming back to that as well. And obviously Hamilton, much bigger stadium as well. I've not actually seen it where we're going to be wrestling, but yeah, terribly excited for that one. The good thing about that one and that match in particular is I have a hidden ace up my sleeve as well. I don't know if you have seen the match graphic, but it is Ravy Davy, Xander, Steg, current Cruiserweight Champion, and Hornswoggle versus three members of the Handsome Man's Club: myself, Judas, Ronan, and then a mystery partner of mine. Now, this mystery partner of mine, like, we have went back years. I mean, years and years and years. We've been on opposite side of the ring many, many a time as well. On the same side of the ring many a time as well. Kind of fallen in and out of love with one another as well. But yeah, it's I don't think the Govan team hit them.
That, now I'm intrigued. Now I'm going to spend a lot of time just going back through your match history and try and make an educated guess. But we won't do it on the podcast because we want people to go there and find out more. And that, I think, you know, off the top of my head, I think I've got an idea possibly. And if it is who I think it is, oh God, God help the Govan team. I think that's going to be a rough night for them. So yeah, Peterhead, we met. It was the first time we actually met. We had a brief conversation. I almost somehow defended. I wanted to defend the honor of SBX, even though you'd had some shenanigans in your four way to take some advantages. But kids are cruel. Kids are feral. Yeah. And have you found that everywhere that you go, with especially in the CPW crowd and the kind of tour, the Govan crowd atmosphere along? Do you find that's your reactions everywhere you go?
Yeah, absolutely. I do find that that is the reactions, because at community pro wrestling, really at the heart of community pro wrestling, as I said, I believe personally that it's the number one promotion in Scotland as well. And part of that is that we bring wrestling to more so deprived communities within Scotland as well. And these deprived communities have never seen such a handsome man in their life. Mm-hmm. And because of that jealousy, they just hurl abuse at myself as well. And I'm doing these cretins a favour. I'm doing these goblins a favour. And the fact that I'm actually gracing them with my presence and currently my belt as well. And yet, in return, all I get is Barbie chants. All I get is princess chants. And just some that really don't fit the nature of this podcast as well. So I won't go into too much detail about them as well. But some that you can... Yeah, real knuckle biters.
I mean, the slurs that I heard in Peterhead was befitting of Peterhead. But yeah, I couldn't believe it. I've never seen a crowd like that for someone And it was just mad. Just yeah, unbelievable that anyone had to deal with that, regardless of what they do in the ring and what they kind of present and what have you. But Jesus, that was an absolute wild night. Like I said, I think I may have said it in the review as well. I think I almost punched a child. It was just like one of those days where I was going,
yeah,
leave me alone. Let me interview the handsome man.
Exactly.
Let's do it.
Peterhead, absolutely uncultured as well. Drumchapel, uncultured. Hamilton, uncultured. Govan, absolutely uncultured. So yeah, like, it's, to be honest, at this stage in CPW, it's to be expected that I'm going to get these torrents of abuse hurled at me as well.
I mean, Helensburgh as well, where you ended up getting, I think it was low blowed by Rob Florence.
Absolutely had no right being in a wrestling ring as well. Right, cool, fine, pay for the ticket, bring your family and just enjoy the show. There's no need for him to get actually involved in the show as well. And I know that a graphic was made to advertise him coming to the show. Cool, very good, Helms Rowan's Rab Florence, but on that, your place is on that front row seat. So you can maybe bring in a few extra fans, cool, very good, but then you watch me, you do my thing as well. You do not touch the family jewels right here at all. That's an absolute no-go. We don't do that here.
I mean, before the low blow and everything that came with that, I think you end up getting a stunner as well that night. But before that, when you knew Rob Florence was there, I mean, it must be kind of, like, you must be looking at CPW and, like you're saying, number one promotion, in your opinion, when it comes to wrestling in Scotland, certainly. But seeing that someone of the history, not only of Scottish wrestling, with the likes of the Kelvin Brawl and that, but Rob Florence coming to CPW, buying a ticket, coming to the show to watch it, that must just put all the work that you've put in CPW and the team at CPW, that must just like tick off, yes, we're doing the right thing, you're doing a good job here, because we're getting people like Rab into the building.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, like, as much as I absolutely detest him, you need to give him his flippers and the fact that what Ravy Davies done for Scottish wrestling in general, just with his online presence, has been like second to only Grado as well. Like, there's no one really within wrestling that really gets the traction that he does as well, and that's testament to the fact that Rab Fordens has come to a CPW show who are still within its infancy as well. The fact that we're drawing these people in, we're getting to tour Scotland, all throughout Scotland as well. Yeah, I think it really does show that, like, we're doing the right thing. Like you said as well, we're getting the product out there. We are putting on the best shows that we can. We're getting brought back repeatedly as well. We're getting demands from the fans to come back to their certain areas. This is why we've been in Peterhead, unfortunately, 3 times now. And then we're just kind of going from strength to strength right now as well, and culminating in the fact that we're doing a show in Hamilton in a football stadium, like an even bigger football stadium in Peterhead as well. I mean, like, wow. It's crazy.
So Bob, going back to your matches, in most of it primarily, do you consider CPW as your home promotion? That seems to be where a lot of
absolutely. Your work is. I mean, like, to be honest with you, I have had offers to go abroad quite recently as well, but right now I'm just not in a position to grace France and grace Spain and Portugal with my presence. I'm firmly enjoying what I'm doing here in Scotland right now, absolutely my home promotion. I said, have had offers to go abroad, but right now I'm going to enjoy what I'm doing, and I'd maybe come next year reconsider going abroad. But for the time being, that, like, if you want to see SBX, and most likely you're going to have to come to a CPW show.
So before we get to the big part of this chat, which will be your CPW title win, there's a couple of matches I want to bring up first. One being your OTT title match with Sammy D. So Sammy, I think, went on to lose the title not long afterwards to Trent Seven, I think, off the top of my head. But again, testing yourself, that was a big weekend in itself. You had the match with Sammy D, then you had the Ticket to the Top Ladder match the next night as well. As far as weekends go, as a wrestler, you said you're on the run of your life. Was that kind of the catalyst for it when you had that OTC world title match, then the ticket to the top?
And let's not forget that the ticket to the top, I wasn't actually officially entered into as well. So I had a match previously on that show as well against one Simon Miller. So that weekend consisted of OTT title match against Sammy D, a match against a YouTube sensation in Simon Miller, and then a six-man ladder match, ticket to the top, in which I wasn't officially entered in. But me being me, just by any means necessarily, seen the weakest link in that match, took Brian Mojo out with a chair, and then went on to win that match as well. And to be fair, never been in a ladder match before in my life. And quite terrifying as well, being up that high. And it's not the sturdiest of ladders, I can tell you that. So there was a few moments where I was praying for my life. And yeah, since then, had another ladder match, been under the same thought process as well. Like, it is high risk and it is terrifying, and like, before you go out there, you really do need to make peace with yourself as well, just in case anything does, touch wood, go horribly wrong as well. But yeah, like, I think you're right, that really was the catalyst as well. That's when the momentum just started. I was on a losing streak, so lost to Simon Miller, obviously lost to Sammy D in that OTT championship match as well. And like, to be fair, OTT, that championship match, maybe I wasn't ready, I don't know. But yeah, being put in that position once again as well, OTT, like, one of the best promotions in Europe by far. Like, absolutely, just like being consistently flying that flag. And it's just testament to the fact that some of their superstars have went on to, like, bigger and better things, like such as Walter. He was a mainstay in OTT for a long time, and now he's World Heavyweight Champion. You've got Jordan Devlin as well, JD McDonough, who was part of the Judgment Day, like being in Raw, and then my friend as well, Valkyra. She's now on Raw as well, traveling all the time, and just, yeah, fantastic to see. But yeah, to get back to your question, like, that weekend, Give Anniversary was absolutely the starting point in this whole commotion that is SBX right now.
I mean, you mentioned all those names, and I mean, you started initially at GPWA. It must be like, it must always be a thing that drives you forward, considering that you've met these people like your Lyra Valkyria. But you've trained with the likes of Wolfgang and NXT and WWE, and, well, Wolfgang's just about to do the cross line over in TNA as well, which is, and Joe Hendry, we've mentioned already, seeing all these people that from the small island, Ireland as well, and Scotland, being able to push themselves to make it to these big companies, and the fact that you've crossed paths with them as well, that must be just the biggest kind of push towards just making yourself better, making yourself undeniable in Scottish wrestling to move forward.
Exactly. And I think, like, there maybe has been a wee bit of a microscope on Scottish wrestling to pick up these talents as well. Like, not saying that it's not for all the hard work that they're putting in as well. I mean, I truly believe that Joe Hendry is one of the hardest workers that I do know. I've known Joe for years now, been part of his podcast, like, way back then, been training under him for a number of years now as well, and like, he's still putting the work in the gym, changing his body physique, and training at the new dungeon as well, under Natalia and Tyson Kidd as well, and just like picking up all these different techniques and bringing it to the school whenever he can get back home as well. So yeah, crossing paths with these people, like I've travelled and trained in other countries as well. So I've trained with Valkyrie in Germany under the WXW training school. trained at Fight Factory Pro Wrestling, trained at School of Irish Wrestling as well. So yeah, like I said earlier, I think iron sharpens iron. You do need to get yourself out there. And in that as well, you're making yourself better, but then like you're passing these people as well. And I think it's just cool to see what these other people are doing as well. And it does give you that wee bit of motivation. Like if they can do it, then yeah, I can certainly do it as well. So yeah, just it's fantastic to see the fact that like these talents are getting recognised and they are getting picked up as well, such as Joe Coffey and Joe Hendry and Wolfgang. Like the fact that like they've represented Scotland on an international scale in WWE and now going to be TNA as well. Fantastic.
So we'll continue with the CPW line and then we'll dot about for other things that you've done since we last chatted as well, because we're well into the community pro side of things, so we'll keep going. So you won the ticket to the top ladder match. Your match was actually announced like to take place on, I think it was night 2 of the tag team tournament, but you cashed in the ticket to the top on night 1.
Yep.
So as far as having that briefcase, was there anything that you drew inspiration from, like going back through Money in the Bank winners to kind of maybe just make your moment as big as entirely possible, like an Edge cash in or the Dolph Ziggler cash in, or trying to make it as epic as possible?
So yeah, like I said earlier, so this weekend coming, LJ Cleary has a match against Nick Nemeth, formerly known as Dolph Ziggler, who has had a massive bearing on my career, my persona. Just like one of the wrestlers that I model myself after as well. So in terms of Money in the Bank Money in the Bank cash-ins, Dolph Ziggler needs to be number one. Like absolute electric atmosphere as well. I don't think anything will ever touch it, just in terms of that reaction as well. And that was a real case of like hard work has paid off for him. So yeah, in terms of inspiration, absolutely drew from that. The match did get announced for day 2, you're absolutely right. But I did send Davey a wee video message when I was on holiday, relaxing, and said to him that like I will be facing him this weekend. I never stipulated that it was going to be day 2. And yeah, it was just unfortunate that he never picked up on it, and he wasn't prepared for it, and wasn't prepared for the pedigree that actually sent him to hospital, and he didn't get home till 6 a.m. the next morning as well, because his shoulder got knocked out of place as well. So the match against Ravy Davey was supposed to be his rematch, and then after that I thought I was going to be done with him, over, done, on to the next one. But no, because he got a wee boo-boo, he sent Caden. Like Caden, product to the Glasgow School of Wrestling. I need to give him his flowers in the fact that he's got an absolutely great work ethic, does really well. There's another few people within the Glasgow School of Wrestling as well that I'd put under that same umbrella, such as Cassie, Bryson, Finn, and then looking at the adults as well, you've got Nick Justice. So yeah, a lot of good talent coming out of the Glasgow School of Wrestling. So David decided to send Caden to go and fight his battle for him, because of course who doesn't need a 16-year-old to fight his battle? And obviously Caden comes up noise and ends, and then I'm thinking that's me done, but no, David just says, right, okay, we're going to find setlist once and for all, and that's where led to the second ladder match that I was in.
Yep, at cease and desist, but not definitely not or was it Clash Before the Bash or something like that? No, Bash Before the Clash, I think initially Before it was Bash, called.
Yeah. Which, absolutely ridiculous, the fact that, like, I don't know if it made it public knowledge, the actual cease and desist that you got sent from WWE, but they were reaching. Like, all my days were they reaching. And the fact that, but do you know what, but like, see, moving aside from that for a wee second, so that's once again a testament to Ravy Davey, and that's a testament to CPW, the fact that like he is getting a cease and desist sent to him from the colossal WWE, whereas I know other Scottish wrestling promotions that were also running that weekend that had similar names, say WWE's premium events, mm-hmm. that didn't get cease and desists So obviously they're down here, and it just shows like the pedestal that CPW are on, the fact that they actually had to change the name of their show, and like the costs associated with that as well. I had to get absolutely new graphics done, had to get new posters done, printed, put out, and just the man hour in that as well. Like, it really cost CPW a lot, the fact that they got that cease and desist as well. But yeah, just amazing the fact that it did happen, because it does show that WWE are recognising CPW as a big promotion within Scotland.
And like I say, it does show that WWE's always watching. Like the in all the pot shots that they get elsewhere, things like through AEW and what have you, they're watching everything. So the fact that they were able to spot a poster that used quite similar signage to Clash at the Castle, the fact that they spotted it, it, like I say, is testament to how big CPW have risen, the fact that it's come across someone's eye that's in WWE as well.
Yeah, absolutely.
That match itself, I saw some highlights, saw some clips, well, possibly low lights for Ravy Davey, because I saw him spill through the ladder, getting pushed off it. So in a multi-man ladder match, you have some moments to rest and get a bit of respite and recover. But a one-on-one ladder match, there's no chance of doing that.
No, there's absolutely no hiding from it. Like you said, there's times to rest and recover in a multi-man match, and you can capitalize and be a bit of an opportunist, and kind of pick your moments in a multi-man when a few people are down. Right, cool, fine, take him out up the ladder. But no, when it's a one-on-one, you're absolutely right. It's like just you and the person that you're standing across the ring from as well. And the fact that if they decide to bring in tables, if they decide to bring in chairs, if they decide to bring in additional ladders, much to Ravy Davies targeting, and the fact that he went through one, really it ups the ante in terms of the danger factor as well. And as I said, like, before you do go out, you do need to have a wee word with yourself and like just make peace with the fact that, you know, I actually might not be walking away from here. It was a very real conversation that you need to have. Like, you see all these stupid spots online, on Twitter, and they do look quite like grim, but it really hits home how bad they actually are when you've been in a ladder match yourself. I mean, like, I still don't think that I've fully recovered from it, and I can tell you that Ravy Davey hasn't recovered from it himself as well. Like, they're right, and they do say it does take years off your career as well. Thankfully for Ravy Davey, he's got skill to rely on as well in terms of like still being involved in wrestling. But like after I'm done wrestling, I think that's me. So yeah, I need to really take care of myself and try and restrict the high danger matches that I put myself in as well. And this is why I surround myself with members of the Handsome Man's Club as well. And the fact that, like, you know, it takes the pressure off me as an individual, puts on us as a unit, and we just keep moving forward.
Did you go into that one maybe a bit more hyped than you possibly may have been? Because of, I mean, I know Ravy Davey must have went in with a bit of a chip on his shoulder, just to kind of prove to, like chip on his shoulder, because WWE made him change all his graphics to his own expense, kind of thing. Did that, and the crowd would have been there just before they're going to Clash at the Castle. They would have been coming to just get a little bit of pre-show wrestling goodness. Did that make you go a little bit harder than you possibly would have in another town on another date, on another day? But because of the things that are going around about it, you just went full pelt for it.
Yeah, no, absolutely. You're quite right in saying that. And the fact that, like, we did have internationally travelled fans coming right over for a wee bit of an aperitif, or digest, aperitif, if you will, of wrestling, to come see CPW before they left for Clash at the Castle. So I think it was a wee bit unfortunate in terms of timings for the show. It did suffer towards the latter half of the show, but my match wasn't affected. Don't know if that's because of the timings. Don't know if it's because they had the draw that is SBX within the match and they didn't want to see it. They wanted to see the ladder match. They wanted to see the fact that the new SBX was going to win, get Ravy Davey through that ladder. But yeah, like speaking to some of their fans before, they travelled from all over the world just to see this PLE, which is quite humbling as well. The fact that they travel from all over the world and then before they go to the WWE, they come to see little CPW, who is now in the eyesight of the WWE as well.
But no, that weekend was just mad. Seeing the shows, I can't remember how many I counted. I think it was about at least 10, 12 shows going on within between the Thursday and the Sunday, within maybe an hour-ish radius of Glasgow, which was just insane to see, even harder to keep track of. That was an absolute headache of a weekend, and I only watched like 3 shows, and that was all streaming. I was just knackered by the end of it, and I wasn't even doing the wrestling, but you guys were. So carrying on the CPW stuff, we'll get to the Joe Hendry match next, which is Bar Mullock, which is just last month, about a month ago. Now this is where the social media kind of comes into play here, because by all accounts, just about all accounts on social media, you're not the CPW Heavyweight Champion. However, you are. So the CPW Heavyweight title, you're in with Joe Hendry. Joe Hendry, he won the match according to records here. If you go on to swnscotland.com, I've got the full results. Don't worry about it for anyone wanting to keep track.
I just want to say right now, you do an absolutely fantastic job in keeping the fans at home up to date with the records. But in regard to that, that was an absolute phallus. So you can change that when you get time after you're off the interview to me. But sorry, continue.
Well, the history books, I don't have Joe Hendry as champion in my title histories. So it's right. It's SBX that's still champion. But bar the result, that must be another one that kind of, you talked about the bookend of the LG Cleary matches, but that must be another one that kind of just must be not bucket list stuff, but one that you could marker your progress on going up against Joe Hendry, someone who's been intricate to your development in the last couple of years, certainly. What was it like actually getting in with Joe? I mean, this was not long after, I don't think it was long after he made his NXT debut as well. So there's a lot of buzz about Joe Hendry. And you're getting in with him.
Yeah. And I think it's a testament to me, the fact that Joe Hendry and himself, like taking the CW side of things away, he is in NXT now, he is in TNA now, he's an international superstar. And the fact that like international superstars before have decided, oh, do you know what? I'm not going to do this wee silly match, anything like that. Like, I just want to focus on what's big and what matters to me. And the fact that Joe Hendry never pulled out that match, Joe Hendry still came to Burma, Joe Hendry still wrestled for CPW, and he still wrestled me as well. So that match with Joe Hendry was years and years and years in the making. I don't know if I've put up the picture before as well, but myself versus Joe Hendry, that was the first time ever that it was supposed to happen for ICW a number of years ago as well. There's a picture of Joe Hendry and I face-to-face, like nose-to-nose, for France 98, I believe it was. So that was the night before the Hydro as well, the night before the first time at the Hydro, like biggest independent Scottish wrestling show, or UK wrestling show, perhaps. At the time, at least anyway. So the story going into that was it was supposed to be down the line, Joe Hendry versus myself as well. Never came to fruition. Really disappointed that it never came to fruition, and I've just been biding my time for the past few years. And then eventually, like you said, did come to a head in Bar Mullock as well. And yeah, as I said, testament to myself, the fact that he never pulled out. He still continued with the match. And yeah, just wanted to test himself against me. And unfortunately for Joe, he did cover me for the 3, but he didn't notice the fact that I had my leg under the ropes. So it was a false 3 count, and it should never have been counted as a pinfall. And this is why SBX is still champ as well. But yeah, you're right. In terms of like, it was a cool moment to have a very much bookended, and it's not severed at all because SBX still has his belt sitting proudly right here.
So I did get a question about that from Kirsten Louise. So I hope that has answered your question there about how you got, how did you get your belt back after Joe had won? So as we've confirmed, Joe did not win. There was plenty of pictures taken of it, and people are going, oh, Joe Hendry's champion. But no, it's that's not the case. We were on the case. SBX is the current, still current CPW heavyweight champion. So don't worry about it. So that's kind of where we're up to a little bit. We've got, of course, future matches like Aki's. You've had defenses since then. Unfortunately, you didn't come up to Peterhead for whatever reason at the time. And our match we'll throw out there for CPW while we're talking about it, and then we'll get into Handsome Man's Club and what have you, is the multi-man match that involved Santino Marella. What was it like getting to work with Santino? Yeah.
So first time being in the ring with a former WWE superstar, absolutely, like, backstage, just need to prepare yourself. But still, it's a pinch me moment sort of thing. And luckily for Santino, him and I never really got to go to tete-a-tete in the ring as well. Unfortunately, I was eliminated before Santino made his entrance as well, but I was not going to let that get in the way of a moment with Santino. And just wanted to really be known as the man that hit Santino over the head with a briefcase in the middle of the oven, because who else can say that? Stormed the ring, missed the briefcase, and then got hit with his stupid Cobra as well. So yeah, that was really my interaction with Santino. Once again, testament to CPW, the fact that Santino has came over as well. But yeah, great the fact that like so many people got to be in the ring with Santino Marella, formerly of WWE and now at TNA as well. The fact that so many people have been given an opportunity to be in the ring with Santino as well, it's something that you don't really see elsewhere as well. But CPW management do like to kind of spread the love a wee bit as well, and really it's like they're giving people a platform to like make a name for themselves, putting themselves against these former WWE superstars. And you know what, if they want to make a big deal about it, then yeah, fill your boots, make a big deal about it, and then just go on to bigger and better things.
But, I mean, you don't see Santino wrestle often nowadays. He's done a couple of blood sports. I mean, I got to see him wrestle up in Aberdeen as well, and that was 2018, I think it was, so it's a while ago. So the fact that he's still willing to put his body online in one of the places he's come to, CPW, again, is testament to him. But you weren't alone in that match, and that segues me very nicely into the Handsome Man's Club chat. We've talked a little bit about version one in the first episode we did, version two a little bit just now with Levi, version three, yourself, Vanity, as they collectively call themselves, Judas Gray and Ronan King, and Ashley Vega, who Ashley was kind of on the outskirts of 2.0 Handsome Man's Club, but she was fully fledged in 3.0. Mentioned kind of spotting Ronan and Ashley and Judas during the Joe Hendry school training sessions or what have you. As a collective though, what's like forming that team and trying maybe to impart some wisdom that you can pass on, bouncing off ideas with each other, because you've all got quite a unique style, certainly when it comes to the different ways someone could present themselves as handsome.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I think to take wrestling out of it for a wee second, like three is my favourite number as well. And like part of that, like, I just believe that this third iteration is the strongest, the best iteration of the Handsome Man's Club. And who knows, might be the final iteration of the Handsome Man's Club as well. One that I really see, like, this is it stuck now. So much so that I've branded up t-shirts with our names on them. as well.
And they're snazzy.
At CPW shows. And yeah, like this is the most kind of committed that members have been to the Handsome Man's Club as well. As I said, the most confident that I am within the Handsome Man's Club. The fact that, like, rightfully so, like you said, we do bring different elements, different aspects, styles of wrestling, presentation to the Handsome Man's Club as well. But we all do come together as a collective, bounce ideas off of one another, and really we are just going from strength to strength just now. Like you said, Vanity, like, great tag team, really hit it off, and Joe Hendry School Wrestling, now Disco Academy, hit it off there. That's where I seen them for the first time as well. They developed a kinship for one another. And yeah, just once again, like I said before, iron sharpens iron, and they both want to be the best. They've both got that bit of competitive rivalry in them, but they also push each other to the limits as well. And this is why you get to see them down south. This is why you get to see them, like, across the water now as well. And yeah, I honestly really think, just because of what time on their side as well, in terms of their age, that the sky is on it for Vanity, and they're just getting better and better every time, like, we see each other.
Yeah, I mean, not a weekend goes by where I'm not seeing Judas and Ronan are they're putting up, like, Instagram stories one after the other, just basically different angles of the same picture, and they're in Wales, or they're in Pursuit, or they're in Ireland, or they're in Europe. And it's just like, geez, if I had the time and the youth, that sounds incredible, just being able to
That's the thing. Like, they've got, like, that's the attitude that you need to have. And, like, back in 2019, that's the attitude that I had as well, in terms of, like, getting yourself to Ireland, getting yourself to Germany, getting yourself, like, to Wales, Pursuit, like, so. And Pursuit weren't around when I was traveling and training. I went down to Fight Club Pro as well. So it's really good to see the fact that, like, they are continuing that work ethic, that they do want to take this wee aspect from, like, each different school and kind of, like, make it their own sort of thing as well. And they're getting featured by these schools as well, and these schools do want to shout about them as well. I think they're doing absolutely fantastic as well. And the same could be said for Ashley Vega as well, who is in herself, getting herself about, known to other promotions as well, south of the border, and trying to make a bit of a name for herself as well. So yeah, I think as a collective, the Handsome Man's Club are just kind of leading the charge right now for Scottish wrestling in terms of the expansion.
Yeah, I mean, Ashley's part of is Joseph Connor's Elevation program.
Yep.
So yeah, she's certainly finding her ways to kind of back up that undeniable moniker that she's just put on herself by doing all these things. She's a very unique talent when it comes to wrestling, because she presents herself as a bit of a diva. She's the modern day diva and all that, does stink faces, you know, the divas kind of moves. But she's got a real prowess for wrestling. Like,
yeah.
not like doing moves, but actual technical wrestling, things that she would have learned through Andy Roberts and at Power Pro and all that kind of stuff, and the Joe Hendry School as well, certainly through the likes of Dave Conrad. She's certainly a unique talent in Scottish wrestling, and Handsome Man's Club have got her in their collective.
Absolute asset to the collective, or asset to the club. Absolutely proud to say that the three of them are fully fledged members of the Handsome Man's Club as well. And just, yeah, honestly, I do think we are the best thing in Scottish wrestling right now as well, drawing all sorts of fans to the product. And at the end of the day, that's what you want. You want more eyes on the product as well. And this is something that the Handsome Man's Club do bring to every show that we're a part of.
So before we get on to the fan questions, because speaking of fans, there's a few fan questions. What was it like getting back into Discovery Wrestling? I mean, you made a return at the Disco Derby, but you made your proper return, I would say, at the A New Era show earlier this year in February, in one of the famed Discovery Four Ways. I've mentioned it a lot of times about marking points where you're noting your progression, but consider CPW one of the most fastest rising promotions in Scotland. Discovery Wrestling, I would say, is probably the constant at the moment, the kind of your pinnacle, whereas CPW is just, like, chasing it very quickly, rapidly at the top. So what was it like getting back in into the fold at Discovery?
So yeah, with Discovery, if I can be absolutely candid here, which yeah, I hope I can be. Discovery was a bit of a sticking point for me for a number of years. So I did start in Discovery as part of the famed Fatal Four Way as well. Three members who now none of them are in wrestling now. From that first four way as well. You can go and look it up.
Yeah, I'm looking at it now. Yeah.
So none of them in wrestling now as well. And then yeah, from that I really struggled to try and get a foothold in Discovery. I did make a couple of appearances after that as well in the Derby and in a handicap match as well against Alexander Darwin, Bacal, ADM, and Zero as well. But yes, it's like it just something never really clicked for me in Disco and just never got the opportunity to come back. But since then, obviously the new era, been in, had the Fatal Four Way, and the two shows since then I've actually been asked to be a part of as well, but due to scheduling conflicts, can't be a part of. So hopefully in shows coming up can be a member of the Discovery roster once more as well, doing some really cool things there for sure. And yeah, I think it's just a case of like bringing Discovery to like their roots again. Yeah, like you said, like was the pinnacle of Scottish wrestling. Arguably it would not say that anymore, but yeah, like so let's just kind of bring the fans back, let's like bring the yeah, the thing that made cool again, the thing that made Disco cool again, back to it as well. And I fully believe that SBX can be a big part of that as well.
I was absolutely 100% listening to that. I just blinded myself a moment by the ring light by switching that on because I didn't put the big light on as well. But no, going through that four-way for all manner of different reasons, yeah, none of them are currently in professional wrestling, but hopefully, so going forward, I know that there's a new team at Discovery, so hopefully we can see a little bit more of SBX. And interestingly enough, that new era, you're in with Ronan King, and of course Judas Grey is the open weight champion there as well. Ashley's always hanging around the women's division, the title picture, somehow, some way, in number one contenders matches and stuff like that. So there's also a handsome man's club contingent, very constant in Disco. So
yeah, absolutely. I think like throughout Scottish wrestling, there is always like an underlying of the handsome man's club. Whether you do go to WrestleZone in Aberdeen, whether you do go to East Coast, West Coast, it doesn't matter. There's always going to be a member of the handsome man's club there as well, which is something I'm very proud of as part of the handsome man's club. The fact that like we're always there as well. So you're absolutely right. There's that kind of undertone of the handsome man's club in Discovery Wrestling right now.
And as I haven't mentioned them yet, you've had a couple of matches at Attitude Pro Wrestling as well, which isn't a byproduct, but it seems to be it runs in line with community pro wrestling as offering a product in maybe underprivileged. That's not the word, but you know, places that don't get as much.
Absolutely. So Attitude Pro Wrestling as well, like I think it's absolutely fantastic. Like does have a similar fan base, but some entirely different fans to CPW as well. I'd probably say they do run like in tandem with one another as a strong collaboration with CPW and APW. But yeah, APW is great. Love the venue that they typically run in as well, in Rutherglen. And yeah, the fans are rabid as well. And it's definitely not helped by the fact that there's a bar in the venue as well. I mean, like, you've seen what Peterhead's like. Just, like, imagine that tenfold as well. So, thankfully, the last APW show, SBX was on the pre-show. So, it was only privileged members of the audience that got to witness me as well. And from that, I could just check out, fine, click my paycheck, see you later. Bye, as well, not having to deal with it. And it was Scheme Goblins from Rutherglen.
So into the questions we go. We've got Ronan King asking, why are all members of the Handsome Man's Club so gorgeous?
Specially selected, Ronan King. We have been specially selected by God to be ridiculously, ridiculously handsome.
Following on from that statement, Big Strong Man has asked, have you got my application yet for HMC? It's been months.
Right, you know what? Funny, so I'm sitting here at my desk, okay? And in these drawers here is all the paperwork as well. And I actually do believe it was due to a clerical error by the Big Strong Man that his application got denied. I think we need to refill it in. So what happened with the Big Strong Man is we've got a series of questions which you do get into after the about yourself. So yeah, cool, fine, filled it in. We're looking for sex. He put sexy, question mark, and then put Big Strong Man underneath. And I was like, right, okay, cool. Can't accept this application. Needs to put it back and sign it in properly, please.
So there you go, Big Strong Man. I know we've got an episode coming up with him very soon as we're recording. And he's got some other issues at the moment with a certain Tom Campbell that I think he needs to organise and sort before he can get that application filled out. But hopefully you'll be able to listen to this and get that in.
Maybe he could be the mystery guest at Anarchy the Akis. Who knows? This could be his trial by fire. He's Mr. Big Strong Man and I have known each other a very long time as well. So yeah, he could be the one that I do rely upon to get rid of Hornswoggle, because I do believe he's in a match with him the night before as well. So I need to draw upon that expertise. So Big Strong Man, you're not entirely at the question, but you just do need to watch yourself when you're filling in the questionnaire. Thanks.
So we've got Lily, Photographs by Lily is the Instagram page. Lily's fantastic for putting up pictures of shows. I'm able to keep track of what's happening at CPW before Kyle is able to get his pictures out. But she's got a couple questions. She said, first one is, what's it like to be the GOAT of CPW?
I mean, yeah, I cannot agree more with that sentiment. The fact that I am the GOAT of CPW as shown right behind me, and the fact that I'm proudly displaying the CPW Heavyweight Championship. But yeah, like I said earlier, absolutely run my life in terms of the match quality that I'm having, people going away, going home, talking to their friends, talking to their mums, talking to their dads, saying that SBX was the best part of their night as well. I'm having little kids come up when I'm selling my merch at the end of the show saying, you're the favourite part of the show for me. And I'm like, yeah, absolutely. Like, do not disagree. It's to be expected as well. So yeah, Lily, being the GOAT, it's something that is to be expected from me.
And also asked, is there anyone else you think is handsome enough to join the Handsome Man's Club, or are you happy with the way Handsome Man's Club is right now?
I mean, to be fair, I'm quite happy. I do think that 4 is a good number of the Handsome Man's Club as well. And I mean, I've got our names on this. Speaking of Lily, I do have her name on this t-shirt as well, as it was a little pre-order bonus. If you pre-order the t-shirt, then you get your name on it. But yeah, I think 4 is a good number, and everything that we do bring to the table for the Handsome Man's Club, like, I don't think anyone else could actually add to that.
And we've got one final question, and I've got a couple more things, and then we can wrap up. It's from TV's Omar Mohammed. He's asked, hello Sam, this is TV's Omar Mohammed, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you, TV's Omar Mohammed. Jesus Christ. you mentioned his name earlier as well, and like right now I just want to apologize to Kyle Watt. Kyle Watt takes some fantastic photos and helps keep the fans at home up to date with the ongoings of CPW as well. And Kyle, I just want to say I'm sorry that I've not been sharing your photos, but like there's been a few iffy ones that, like, a handsome man like me who, like, 95% of the time does not take a bad photo, it turns out 5%, you catch that 5%, so I can't really go sharing some of these, like, not very nice photos of myself. So this is why my Instagram socials have been a wee bit quiet in terms of your photos. So I'm sorry, but you're just going to, that 5%, just get rid of it.
You mentioned your t-shirt there, and Of course, I've got a little bit of SBX merch because I'm now a trading card guy. I don't know. I've made that clear in a few episodes now. And I've got it in my little British wrestling magazine pocket here. But I do have an SBX trading card, which, you know what, if I organised myself, I would have had it looked out already. But in interim, got a wee Ashley Vega kiss card as well. But when you're putting together merch, I mean, trading cards are such an easy thing nowadays to, or should be, a no-brainer thing to put out. What was it like putting that together, and was that your same thought?
Seeing that, sorry if I'm slightly off camera just now, but yeah, in seeing that, trading cards are actually quite hard to put together.
I know, I've got my one out. There we go.
Fantastic. Well, in my hand, I've got the stickers here as well. So, two different logos. So this is the Warriors style one. And then here's the other one as well, the World is Yours style one as well. So I've got a couple of stickers here as well. So over here is my merch drawers, I guess. So that's where I keep everything before I head out to the shows as well. But yeah, in terms of merch, I've always been quite big on merch as well, and I do like t-shirt designs and the likes. This is why, like, I've got a new t-shirt design every couple of months as well. And I do think, in terms of t-shirts in Scottish wrestling, at least I know, like, no one does it like me. Like, my t-shirts have always been primo, number one, fantastic, just in terms of the quality that they are, in terms of the design that they are. They'd be ones that you'd be proud to wear out and about, and they don't necessarily have that wrestling fan stink as well. But in terms of the trading cards were actually quite hard to do. So the trading card that you have is actually a double-sided business card that got printed. They don't have any details on it, but it's from a business card manufacturer.
Can't
get done. So yeah, but that, so if you can look at the back of that once again, I know you've just put that for the third time, but the back of that, I do have a t-shirt design with that as well. This is based off of Kanye West Yeezus, which is based off of Metallica as well, so that's where that font came from as well.
But no, I think this should be just a thing nowadays, because I mean, look at my wall of crap here. It takes up a lot of space, and 8x10s, cool, they take up a bit of space as well, but a trading card that you can go to a show, get it signed, like, I honestly think that should be what wrestlers should be doing. I'm trying to find, because recently I went to Disco and I got Leon Slater signed one. You know, that's a rookie card that you see what Leon Slater's doing, and he just had these cards lying around ready to sign. So, you know, wrestlers, get on it. Trading card people that can produce trading cards, get some deals going, get some brand deals going. I will be taking that advice on the business card thing. I'm noting that down for myself.
Similar to that as well. Now this has really been a pipe dream for me. Okay, and obviously at the end of the day, wrestlers just think about themselves in terms of like, right, how can I make money off this as well? So like for like the t-shirts, the business, no, the trading cards, the stickers, like, cool, fine. But something that I would really love to do is a sticker album akin to your Panini sticker albums. I think that'd be absolutely amazing. Would someone want just a Handsome Man's Club only sticker album? I'm not too sure. Maybe you would need a wider collection, such as like CPW, but then you need to think about like, right, who does the money go to, sort of thing. I know that's not something for the fans to think about. They just want the stickers. But yeah, as a wider piece, I would love to have a sticker album, a Scottish sticker album. I think that'd be good. And like you said, doesn't take up too much space as well. Could be a few rookie cards on that as well before they go on to bigger and better things, which you can absolutely see a lot of the people in Disco Academy, like such as Judas and Ronan, the people in Glasgow School of Wrestling, such as like Finn, Cassie, Bryson, Danny Mullet as well, Caden, Bo, I can see them going on to like getting better things as well. So yeah, Absolutely. I do think if there was some sort of like sticker option, then that'd be very cool.
Oh, I'm all in. If I mean, I wouldn't know what to do myself, but if a GoFundMe appeared, or a Kickstarter appeared that could make this happen, I'm investing. That's definitely something I'll get involved with. But yeah, I mean, I did a few of the trading card pop up things, the Martin McAllister one, like Pokemon card kind of things. I actually had one for you as well, but I never finished it. It was pink. I made it pink, and I just couldn't think of what the stats could be, and that's kind of how it went into my development hell of ideas.
Maybe you and I can speak about this a wee bit offline as well, then we'll kind of bring that to fruition.
We'll get that going. But no, as far as future goes, then we've talked about your present. We know what's coming up with things like Anarchy at the Aki's. You seem to be in a really good place for wrestling. Like I said, last time we had this chat, we were, I mean, Scottish wrestling is still tense. It's still a tense atmosphere. There's still things happening that you're seeing and you can't do anything about and you don't want it to be happening. But generally, there's a good 80% chunk of companies that are doing really well and wrestlers that are doing really well. Are you, you're on the run of your life? Are you happy in wrestling? Are you happy with what you're doing? And have you got any future aspirations, or are you just taking it as it comes?
Yeah, no, absolutely. I think, right now, I'm 30 years old as well, which, like, some would consider to be old within wrestling in terms of an athlete as well. But then, no, because, like, when you look at, like, Joe Hendry, when you look at, like, DDP, everyone uses DDP, everyone uses Batista. But, yeah, the fact that, like, you can be those few years older, just get that wee bit of experience underneath you, and you can still go on to the big time as well, absolutely amazing. So yeah, I'm happy where I'm at just now. The lifetime goal for me, end goal, is to make a living out of wrestling as well, and I do think some people are like doing fantastic in that as well. But yeah, currently right now, absolutely happy with what I'm doing. Flying the flag for CPW, being the face of the operation for it, in terms of, once again, in terms of match quality, in terms of being the poster boy of CPW as well. Future plans, yeah, as I said earlier, like, might look to get abroad once again as well, taking my brand of je ne sais quoi to other promotions across the pond. Yeah, absolutely. And then, yeah, hopefully always working towards that end goal of being able to support myself primarily through wrestling.
Fantastic. Well, so I hope next time we do this, if it's in our 2 years down the line, I'm going to have to go through some reps to try and get hold of you, like I have done recently for some other wrestlers.
Do you know what? Like, listen, I think that's absolutely ridiculous, the fact that you need to go through reps as well. Surely someone can just be like, right, okay, cool, I appreciate what you're doing for the culture of Scottish wrestling as well. Do you know? Yeah, fine. I'll absolutely accept that. Because, I mean, you've had some, like, real big names on the show as well. Like, let's not take anything away from SWN. You've had some real big names in the show. And I'd imagine you didn't need to deal with the reps then as well. So I think people can just be a wee bit too hoity-toity and up themselves before they accept anything. So, yeah, absolutely disrespect meant when I say that, by the way.
Oh, I will tell you now, I never had to go through any reps to get Scotty Hoy. That's all I'm saying. Yeah. I badgered him for months, but I got him. But no, just the way it is. Contracts, you know, big companies, just the way it goes through PR and media. But we get them, we eventually. But we'll see how things pan out. But thankfully, we're able to find some time, because I know that you yourself, in all matters of life, are a very busy man, and we were able to get this chat back.
Yeah,
in, we're able to get it going.
Something that, obviously we've had a few scheduling conflicts as well, but something that I have been looking forward to as well, and something that, like, I didn't want to do too soon as well. I really wanted to bring something such as a title one to the show as well, maybe speak about the past a wee bit as well, which we have as well. There's been a lot of names that I've not mentioned as well, on the show. So Yeah, like just it's been good to be back on the show as well. Really, really enjoyed my time here as well, and just want to give a few people the flimmers right now as we're closing off as well. As you mentioned, trained in GPWA as well, like many moons ago, got to train under like five of the best coaches that you would ever get, sort of thing as well, and really kind of base myself on that. But out with that, I mean, like, take a shot for this time, I say it now, but iron sharpens iron, and this is why, like, you need to surround yourself with the best as well. This is why you surround yourself with the crowbars of the world, like real hard hitting sort of thing with a legitimate background. This is why you surround yourself with Stevie James as well. Stevie James himself as a wrestler, just going from strength to strength, like kind of cut ties with himself as a purge and moving on to single titles. Xander, like, I'd be remiss without mentioning Xander again on this podcast. Like, Xander is absolutely one of the most underrated talents in Scotland as well, and it's an absolute sin that he doesn't push himself and get himself out there more as well. He himself is happy with where he is at CPW and like as head coach at Glasgow School of Wrestling as well, but there's so much more that Xander could do if he just got himself out there as well. So yeah, Xander, absolute phenomenal talent as well. And then of course Leighton Buzzard, so collectively along with Raby Davy as well, like we all had a big kinship. And yeah, Leighton Buzzard obviously just doing tours of Japan now as well, being it's an absolute hero of British wrestling. And yeah, unfortunately had a serious injury a few months ago, but yeah, he's on the mend and he's just going to come back bigger and better than ever as well. So yeah, I'm really looking forward to seeing what Leighton Buzzard brings to the table when he comes back.
Perfect. Well, I think that's a good way to round off the show here. So plug your stuff. We've talked about the merch. You're showing off the merch as well.
Yeah.
About the trading cards and what have you. But where can people find out more about SBX if they should choose to?
Yeah, so my handles on all social medias should be at Sam Barberex. You find me on Twitter, not too active on Twitter. I will go on it, but I don't really do stuff on it. Instagram as well, at Sam Barberex. That's where you'll see me most. SamBarberex.bigcartel.com. There'll be a link to it in my Instagram bio as well. That's where you can get the merch. That's where you can get balaclavas. That's where you can get t-shirts, trading cards, stickers, all sorts on that as well. But yeah, Sam Barberex is where you'll find me.
Fantastic. Well, thank you very much for taking time to speak to me. I'll probably have another chat off camera and off recording, but this is what we can keep in the recording anyway. We'll go off and slack folk off and outside that. But thank you again, and yeah, look forward to next time.
Me too. Speak to you soon.